put off by how long this video is, don't worry, I try to jam-pack my videos with as much content and as much detail as I possibly can. Anything I feel I can comment on and that I feel you might be interested in, I pretty much put in the video. I try not to repeat myself and talk fairly fast. Dead Space video game review. It just occurred to me. This game was made by EA. And by the division that made The Godfather, which is truly terrible, even for a licensed game. EA, this is not news to anyone, but the reason EA is terrible is because they take no risks. They keep just adding to, you know, entries to their series. They don't really make original properties, and their games are loaded with bugs. And if you take the title Dead Space, if you remove both D's, you have EA. And if you take away the SPC and then reverse what you have left, that's another EA. Seriously though, this one is the exception that proves the rule, pretty much. Engineer Isaac Clarke and his crew respond to a distress call and, of course, as you do, end up stranded on the large, seemingly abandoned mining ship, the Ishimura. It's a planet cracker. And sometimes when you crack a planet, something comes out of it. You are then going to have to repair the severely damaged many systems of the ship, defeat the many aliens, and try to solve the mystery of what happened. And of course, there's it's even personal because your romantic partner was serving aboard the Ishimura. Might she still be alive? Might you be able to save her? Of course, you know, it does boil down to, you know, there is someone that might still be alive that you have to save. The fact that it's your girlfriend doesn't really make it, it might, you know, you might as well be going there to safely retrieve Porthos. Why did I say that name? Why did I say that name? And what does this have to do with this cultish religion of Unitarianism? I mean, Unitology, which is definitely not Scientology. And of course, you may encounter some people still alive, not infected. There is very little personality to Isaac, who he is who you spend most of the game as, and, well, he's the only person you play as, but most of the game is just spent with him. You pick up logs and you are, you know, communicated to, never really with, since you don't really respond. It's that kind of, video game kind of where, no, you don't have to say anything. You don't even have to acknowledge that you heard what I said. I'm just going to say something and that's going to aid the player. But yeah, you know, he's the person you spend the most time with, you might say. And yeah, he doesn't really have much personality. You only see his face at the very end. And yeah, he never speaks. There's a little bit of personality expressed through, like, objectives. You know, he'll write something down, and he'll maybe seem especially, like, frustrated with the current situation or the like. But I'm not asking for like monologues or a lot of interaction. Just something that the Silent Hill games do that really works is that the character will, and I'm talking about the good Silent Hill, the real Silent Hill, the first three games, really. What they'll do is they will actually react when they see something really twisted, and you can tell that there's a person there, it's not just like, I mean, I already said, about the girlfriend Nicole. Isaac himself might as well be an automaton. Now, parts of this were written by Warren Ellis, the prolific comic writer, and it's been noted that that's probably where the plausible but science fiction concept, of planet cracking comes. Some of this is futuristic. It is set like 500 years in the future or something, so it's not like tomorrow. But yeah, some of it is futuristic, and some of it feels like, it's more or less the same as we have today. The script, depending on what reviewer you read, it's been called everything from film worthy, not the most gripping, to downright worthless. I wasn't that compelled by it. I will say that there are interesting ideas there, but ultimately, I don't think to some it will really engage, but that really wasn't my experience. And thus, begins the negatives about this. I will say there are some definite positives to this, and I wish I could. I wish there were more. I wish that the negatives weren't there or weren't quite so negative. But there are definitely some really good elements in this. Now, the storytelling is entirely linear, and in general, this is very linear. You realize fairly early on how it's going to. It's. I respect the decision to label every level in this, but I don't think that it was the most. I think it was the wrong choice. I think it should have done like Half-Life, System Shock, and not really said this, told you when you enter a new area of the game. It just, like, in those games, you can maybe say, well, okay, now I have, now I'm entering a new area. Actually, I believe, yeah, Half-Life 1 did kind of, there's a name for each like overall area, and it's not like just a designation. It's an actual like, dramatic title. But it isn't particularly distracting, where in this it is literally, when you complete a level, it says, title of level completed, and just. And it really didn't need to draw attention to itself, because the rest of the game very specifically does not call attention to the fact that it's a video game. And it person perspective notwithstanding, of course, but yeah, I would have preferred if they had just. And really, it's. I'm not going to give away exactly how, but yeah, like I said, you're going to realize pretty early on how it happens. And the thing is, it's, yeah, like I said, you're gonna realize it's the same. It's every time you complete a level, it happens in the same way. And yeah, it's that you're moving from one area to another. And you could say, well, of course that's where the level ends. For one thing, it's really the fact that it is the exact same, so it feels like you're just in System Shock 2. Yeah, it feels like you're just, completing levels. It draws attention to the fact that it's a video game and that you have just completed a level. And there are games that do that well. There are games where that's useful, and if you go, originally that was the way video games worked. You have completed level number this, and now you will enter the next level. That was just how it had to be. But this, yeah, it goes against the verisimilitude of it not feeling like a video game. In System Shock 2, you don't. In a lot of the game, the way you move between areas is to take the main elevator between the different floors of the ship. And that isn't how the game starts out. For the first, the first several areas, the main elevator is offline. So when when you've played it for long enough, when you get to the area where the elevator, because you keep seeing it on every level, it's an elevator. It's completely, vertical. So of course there's only one area on each floor, but you keep passing it every floor you're on. And you can press the button, but it's just gonna say main, I forget if it's main power offline, I want to say it is. Yeah. And the main elevator, of course, uses main power. And when you finally, it happens early. This is not a spoiler. When you actually get to, putting restoring main power, then you get to use this main elevator, and you can go between the floors you've already gone between, And it feels earned. It feels like, okay, I've actually, now I have restored main power to this ship. This was a big deal. And the fact that in this it's the same, it just, yeah, it kind of takes away from the realization. Because in this you make big, when you repair things, not always, but sometimes it is a very big deal. And it, the goal of a given level tends to be something that will really help you in, escaping, or some, or just make it, if you don't do this, you will die, because this, yeah, if you don't do this soon, you will just straight up die from, I mean, you're in space and this place, this ship is really badly damaged. So you are making a big difference. But the moment you see that level completed screen, it just, yeah. And excuse me. And another thing is the fact, excuse me, that it does, the main elevator in System Shock 2 opens it up. Now you can, before it was maybe like, well, you can get to the floor, the floor above you, let's say. But since the main elevator is not working, well, there is this one like specific place where they have like a ladder, and you can just open a hatch and go between the two, because just in case something was going on with the main power, you can move. It's like engineering. You're moving, one of the two areas you're moving between is engineering. obviously you want to be able to go to and from engineering without the main power being online. It might be really dangerous to be in engineering with the main power online, or there might, something might happen that an engineer might have to deal with. The engineer might have to move out of engineering in order to fix that. Yeah, there's a hatch. And in, when you get the elevator, you can just go between floors. One of the, the first time you play it, it's like so exciting that you just, oh, I want to go to that floor again. I know I've already been there, but I want to try to leave through the elevator doors. That'll be cool, and things like that. And in this, you can't even choose to go back and forth. The game decides where you're going next, and it's, obviously it's going to be where you need to go to solve the next objective. But again, in System Shock 2, it's not like you're going to be going back and forth between the different floors not knowing. It tells you you have to do this by going to this particular floor. So in that, it's that you get to take it at your own pace, whereas in this, it's kind of just, okay, are you ready to complete the level? Because this is completing the level. And it's the storyline is very predictable. A bunch of things will go wrong, and you'll end up in, exposed situations where you have to then deal with it. And yeah, these situations tend to be, fairly similar. The cover of this one, and I want to specify this one because I have checked out the cover of the second game, and it which I don't I only got this one, and I don't think I'm gonna be going any further into the franchise. But yeah, the cover of, and the cover of the third one, as far as I've been able to tell, are different from this. But in this one, the cover really reminds me of Left 4 Dead 1 and 2. You've got this cut off arm with the fingers outstretched, the title in capital letters over a nondescript background that is mostly, one color with, like gradients and stuff, but mostly the one color. It just, yeah. It's not a very Left 4 Dead-ish game, so I don't quite. Anyway, I'm not going to be surprising anyone by saying that this is similar to a number of other games, and at least one movie, because it does wear it on its sleeve. It's not trying to hide that it is. I've already brought up System Shock, System Shock 1 and 2, BioShock 1. Now, there's a similarity between this and BioShock 2 as well, but BioShock 2 did come out after this game, so it's not like this took ideas from it. Event Horizon, Alien, Aliens, Resident Evil, although I've played through the second game, and I don't have any other real. I played the one with the light gun thing, and you wake up and you've lost your memory, and it's like it's completely different from the rest of them. Those are the two that I've played, but apparently this is especially similar to Resident Evil 4, really taking a number of like elements and dynamics from it. And two games that I have not played at all, Doom 3 and Condemned. I have played Doom 1 and 2. Even in the 90s, I wasn't really into this super dark, extreme kind of thing, but Doom 1 and 2 definitely, I mean, they are seminal games. Without them, first-person shooters would not look the way they do today. But if we're going with classic shooters, I much prefer Wolfenstein 3D. Now, the like some of the titles that I've just mentioned, this is very much a haunted house in space. There's Everywhere you go, you can see that something happened here and someone, something bad happened here. And you can hear like far off sounds and there's this one part that, it has this the children's song Twinkle Twinkle Little Star is like being sung creepily. I swear, children's songs exist, much like, other stuff that's thought of as for children. Dolls and clowns and such, they exist so that they can be creepy in horror fiction. Anyway, it's going for kind of atmospheric survival horror. And it is a third-person shooter, and the over-the-shoulder, it's the specific perspective. They've basically placed the camera so that Isaac obstructs about half the screen. Others point out it's the equivalent of playing with one eye closed. Personally, I kept not seeing things on the ground until it prompted me. When you're close enough to something that to an item that you can pick it up, there will be this little holographic prompt to pick it up. I couldn't see the floor for several meters in front of me. Or no, rather, you can't for Isaac. So I kept having, eventually I just said, okay, before I walk too far, let me just move the camera so it's like, so I'm looking down, which I shouldn't have to do. In a third-person game, I should be able to see the ground around me, but yeah, he obstructs, which, to say nothing of all the time he obstructs when you're trying to, see where the creatures are and such. For some reason they didn't put him in the actual center. He's taking up the left half of the screen instead. I've been playing Arkham Asylum and Arkham City recently as well, and in that, the moment that you are in a combat situation, the camera, because in that, Batman is obscuring a bunch of the screen when you're just walking around, but the moment that you need to, you can see exactly what you need to. The moment that you're in a combat situation, the camera will pull back. And it will pull back the more enemies, pull back further the more enemies that there are. So, yeah, you have a great view of it. You can see enough that you can, get your bearings on the situation. And that's what really never happens here, which. People are going to say, well, he's an engineer. He's not supposed to be that good at combat. If it was, even so, having that, I mean, it comes off more like he's just not, used to walking around and looking at things because that's where it starts. That's difficult. Combat being difficult because your character is not like a warrior makes sense, but you can do that without it negatively affecting so many other areas of the basic interaction. And, this is very much a shooter. It is an action-oriented game. There is tremendous attention to detail, something one of my favorite aspects of this, one of the things I am especially going to take away from it, is the scope and just when you're seeing machines working on the ship, when you I'm going to be giving examples later on, but just, yeah, these machines that are many times bigger than you, where, you know, you have to really take steps back and look up, and you'll still barely be able to see the whole thing, and you might see these huge doors just slowly opening, or these, you know, it's like you're watching the cogs of a machine as this machine is working, and as technologically advanced as the machines that power this ship are, they still, you know, because of the enormity of the task that they're undertaking, it takes a little while, you know, and you can see it as it's happening, and that really, it makes you feel so tiny and insignificant on this map. It really tells you this is how small you are in the, you know, in what's going on here. You know, even this machine, this one machine on this huge ship can take, you know, because you do spend most of the game, I'm not gonna go into detail any more than that, but you do spend most of the game on the Ishimura, and yeah, just the you know, it so yeah, you're spending all these hours on this one, you know, overall location pretty much, and yeah, just these moments that really highlight just how big it is. The fact that this ship is so huge, and you know, as you explore more of it, you realize just how much of it is completely overrun. It really, you know, that's in this kind of horror story, this is, again, you know, something, you know, Silent Hill accomplishes this by the roads being like, you know, just having these huge cracks, as though it's like there was a huge earthquake or something that just separated these, you know, that makes you realize whatever is going on here is this powerful, is this huge. And, you know, not every horror story needs something like that, but yeah, you know, Halloween isn't a story about the vastness of, you know, but when you have a story that relies on how vast this is, yeah, it's incredibly important to have this kind of, and System Shock 2 doesn't have, you know, they wouldn't have been able to, but, you know, I'm not making excuses for System Shock 2, but they chose to do it in other ways, and, well, you know, a really, one of the ways that's most noticeable in System Shock 2 is that there are all these windows, and you can walk up and you can look right out these windows, and you just see this endless, you know, star-filled sky, and it's like, I am not near Earth. I am not even remotely anywhere near Earth, because that's a huge part of that, you know, it's traveled so far away from Earth, and you are so very far away and so very alone. And rather than this doing that again, they, you know, they used the fact that now you can, you know, when this came out, you could, you know, doing great, you know, every single cutscene is in engine. It never cuts to something and then you're watching it pre-rendered. Every time you're seeing these huge detailed machines at work, you're, you know, It's you seeing it. It's you know, and like I said, you can, you know, take steps back and pull the camera, and it's the half-life kind of thing. You get to choose what you're looking at for the most part. There are, you know, ones that are guided where the game will take control from you for a little bit, but the vast majority, you're watching it, you know, entirely on your own. Yeah. And you know, for all the time that you spend in darkness, there are other parts where it's incredibly vividly bright instead, because you know, you're right by this planet, and you're not out in the vast emptiness of space. You're, you know, this is the, you know, there's a colony that is, so you know, it's not just, and that is, you know, because horror, you know, darkness doesn't necessarily equate to horror, and brightness doesn't mean that you feel safe. It just again really highlights the enormity of the, you know, what's going on and where you are. Others have noted this is a bad PC port. It's, you know, the controls and the way the mouse, yeah. I really, this again briefly, Arkham Asylum and Arkham City, the only two Arkham games I've played. The controls really work on the PC as well. It's not this really. Honestly, some of them almost must have been different. I've never played it on anything other than the PC, but I figure you know, the gadgets having specific numbers almost must be specific to the PC with the keyboard and all. But yeah. I'm not going to go into why I haven't played beyond Arkham City in this. I did a review on Arkham City, so. And this is internally complete. It wasn't made in order to start a series. It did, and you can see why. There's, you know, one of the best things about this is the world that it, you know, you want to see more, you want to spend more time, you know, on ships like the Ishimura with Isaac Clarke. And the yeah, it's it, you know, me playing only this one, the story is complete. I don't, there's not something that I'm certain that I'll learn more about the world when I play, you know, if I were to play the sequels, but it doesn't rely on you know, going further. I suppose this is a fine place to just briefly state the ending has this really lame and unnecessary twist, and the ending, like the rest of the story, is just okay. And this kind of storytelling, where I forget who said it, but someone said of System Shock 2 that most of the plot has happened already. You're just playing catch up. You are piecing together what happened here. How did we get here from what was supposed to be completely routine? This was not expected to be this huge, you know, in both that and this, it's not a military mission. There might be some, you know, security personnel or something, but you know, this was not like, this is not, you know, this is not Starship Troopers where, you know, the soldiers arrive and how could they, you know, they had a good position here. The enemy must be especially strong that they could overrun this military position. No, this is just, nothing was supposed to go wrong here. Nothing was expected to go wrong. So what happened? And yeah, in these, again, System Shock, the System Shock games, BioShock 1 and 2. I have 3. I haven't gotten around to playing it yet. Yes, I finally gave in. I want to say actually Resident Evil 2, although it has been an eternity since I played that game. You are piecing together what happened. You are finding little bits and pieces of the story. And that does happen here, but the moment that I completed the game, it told me, after the end credits, it opened the new game plus option. And among the things there was backstory logs unlocked. And I get that excuse me, that's supposed to entice you to play it again, but that's just the wrong choice. Backstory should be there when you play it the first time. It's not a bonus, it's a major component. It is the story. Because again, the rest of it is just, okay, well, I can tell that this part needs repair. Go there, repair it. And then either on the way something goes wrong, or when you get there, or maybe you do in fact repair it, but then something else goes wrong. That's not so much plot. That's, if you made a movie out of this, that wouldn't be considered plot. When you watch Event Horizon, yeah, they're going around repairing things. But what actually happens is the haunting kind of stuff. That's the story. And in this, that just isn't that compelling. So you need to let us delve into this backstory. It's been a while, but I replayed BioShock to, and System Shock 2, as if I needed an excuse to play that game again. Did I mention that I actually played it not long after it came out? I've been playing it pretty much since it came out. Yeah, I replayed those two games, and then I also made some notes when I played Dishonored for the one and only time I'll ever play that game, or anything in its franchise. Some new games have way too much of one single action that you have to do over and over. Dishonored is like a lesser thief game, but there is way too much to read, and too much of it is just, you're sitting there and you're reading for very long instead of just these little bits. Again, compared to Thief, Thief has much less to read, and what there is to read tends to be fairly short, and from that you have to piece together what the whole world of this game looks like. Dishonored is just always telling you, even as you see so much of it, you're still constantly being told. And in BioShock, again, I'm not gonna rag too much on that game. And I did a video on that game as well. And I do stand by what I said in it. I could probably do a better review of it today, but I stand by what I said on it in that video. It's a spiritual successor to the System Shock games. And there's way too much hacking in BioShock. I forget if it's true of BioShock 2, since that game is much shorter. You can clear it in a single sitting. And I've only played that once because I forget what, it might be the DRM or something. It will not let me play that game again. It's really frustrating. Yeah, there's too much hacking, and then both of those games are also entirely too long. And I appreciate when it comes to Dishonored, I made the choice myself. I played entirely stealthy and entirely non-lethally. I did not have to do that. I could have, run through it faster. Nevertheless, Yeah, a lot of these newer games miss, think that more is more rather than less. And no, it is not up to the player to stop doing something if they find it tedious. It is up to the developers to prevent any element of their game to become tedious. And once again, both System Shock games and all four Thief games really just do a better job of that. I'm not saying that Thief 2014, I want to say, that the most recent Thief game is all in all a better game than Dishonored. I realize that that's not the case. And yeah, I am very relieved to say that that is just not the case here. It's some say it's too long. It took me 12 hours. And yeah, some reviews just straight up say it should only have been 6. I guess ultimately it's also just, is the are you enjoying playing it? And to me, I didn't enjoy it that much, but I was never really like just like BioShock 1. I maintain there is at least one stop too many on the path to the end. At least one. Because near the end, both of my playthroughs, I'm like, can this please end? This is getting really, yeah. And yeah, Dishonored, yikes. But the yeah, I wouldn't say that this feels. No, I think that it keeps having interesting settings, and the things you do, like one way to prolong games. That's also some, having just replayed the story of Arkham City. Man, there is a lot of, okay, go here. No, actually, go here. Nope, go back here. In that story, which is another thing that Asylum just does far better. But yeah, in this, I never felt like it told me to do the same exact thing. There were like twists along the way. There were things where you maybe think that, okay, well, this is going to resolve it all, but then something else happens. But it tends to have something interesting new there. Like, then when, when it maybe goes wrong, and then you have to like pick up the pieces and fix something else, then you realize, oh, this was actually, oh. And that, I think, yeah, I would say it is not too long. Although if you really don't, if, like I said, I enjoyed elements of this a lot. And if you do not enjoy even those elements, if there are not a lot of elements in this that you enjoy, yeah, you're not gonna want to play it through. And it's likely, if you're not really into the scope, the changing settings, and suppose, yeah, the level design. If they do not really, compel you to play on, and if you also don't enjoy the gameplay in general, yeah, you're not gonna enjoy the game. If you start playing and you early feel like, ugh, this is not really for me, and those elements don't appeal to you, the game is not going to be for you, plain and simple. And that is also something there are things in this where they made the wrong choices, but there are other things where they made the exact right choices. And those choices, yeah, throughout the entire game, you can see the positive effect of those choices. And because of that, a lot of games that turn out not that great Maybe they weren't a labor of love, or you can't really tell that they were. In this, you can tell. This was definitely created by people who were passionate about what they were making. And that's something I don't think the wrong choices were made because they didn't care. I think they just had bad instincts on some of these things. And this also, unlike those two games, is not excessively streamlined. But yeah, there are just a lot of things in Bioshock. I know that technically Bioshock 2 is way more like mainstream and way less interesting, but it's just so much more fun to play. And yeah, but there are a lot of decisions made in the making of Bioshock that just have you going, why, 2K? The visuals in this are thoroughly impressive. There was, when you can see it for Isaac, everything looks fantastic. And it uses some, the general color scheme. There's a lot of like rusty orange. This is also sometimes, rusty orange, this metallic gray, and this kind of light blue. And yeah, it uses those well. This isn't that what they say, that every Hollywood movie now is orange and blue or something like that. In this, it doesn't really bother you. It certainly didn't for me. And it uses these well to kind of, obviously the rusty orange makes really uncomfortable because it's like, I am in space. Well, rusty is always good. Silent Hill also use rust really well. But yeah, you're like, I am walking on something rusty. Is this going to break? Because if it does, I might die from it. It's not a comfortable thing to be around. And then these metallic grays have this kind of effect of it's kind of dehumanizing. That's also something these great, huge machines do. This is not a place that it's safe for me to be. If that door that's taking several seconds to, be opening, be pulled up. If that thing breaks, even if I'm not that close to it, just the impact of it is going to shatter my bones. This is not a place I want to be. And you do actually get to go in really especially dangerous areas and around like engines. And if engines, maybe deteriorate some, they might be incredibly volatile to be near. And this is the kind of situation where you'd want someone to just turn it off temporarily so you can go in close to fix it. But the guy who's supposed to be turning it off, he's dead. That the place where you're supposed to go and you can press a button and it'll be turned off. Well, yeah, that machine's broken. So there you go. And these light blue, like I said, even when bathed in light, this can be very uncomfortable. So yeah, it uses that well. That's something that's such a pitfall for it can be really devastating to a lot of horror fiction if everything looks the same. Because yes, if you want that, in this and in Silent Hill, the rust is really uncomfortable, and there's a lot of it, but there's not too much of it. It's not so much that it wears you down. This can be very intense, and it's a very violent game and very aggressive in its horror. And as others have pointed out, it's more gory than frightening. The it just does not provide the rest periods that really contrast well with the intensity. Again, something that Silent Hill does phenomenally, and both System Shock games as well. It just gets to be kind of. Actually, yeah, I'll be getting to that, how the gameplay itself, the action. You don't always know when, something is going to jump out at you, but it is basically pretty much all jump scares. Something that is, excuse me, very effective, and I really wish they'd done more of it. And something where it isn't jump scares is that when you are in zero G, as we know, there's no, actually, is that just zero G or anyway, there are these parts where there's no sound. And unlike what Spoonie said, it's not really noisy because there isn't all that air getting in the way. It's actually complete silence. And man, I love Spoonie. Why does Spoonie not do videos anymore? He occasionally like wrestling, but does he not watch movies anymore? I haven't seen a Spoonie watched this or that movie. I don't know, maybe he's tired of people claiming that he hates everything. Anyway, yeah, there's no sound. So enemies like walking around, or like I think it even cancels out the music. And this is actually, I mentioned earlier that typically EA do games that don't take risks. Having actual vacuum of sound, that's a risk. A lot of people are going to tear off their headphones in righteous fury, screaming, "If I can't hear it, how can it be scary?" A lot of people don't appreciate that complete silence can be one of the most terrifying and ways to approach sound. And yeah, you can't hear the enemies screeching at you. You can't hear them walking. You can't hear them attacking. Just so if you aren't careful in those situations, you'll want to every so often just scan the area, look everywhere to see if there's an enemy. And this still doesn't go against what I'm going to be saying about gameplay, but it is, nevertheless, it's where there isn't jump scares. If you don't scan the area every so often, then at some point suddenly you just see Isaac, like, you'll see him be attacked. You'll see him take a hit, or you'll see an enemy's limb coming into view as they're attacking you. And even then, all you can hear is a low grunt from Isaac, which, of course, because you are Isaac, so if you grunt, you will be able to hear that. But nothing else can be heard. That is very effective. I really wish they did more with silence and build up in this instead of relying on jump scares. The setting is, of course, very isolated. You're completely alone, pretty much. Again, the voices on the radio and such. It's very gloomy, and there are areas that are very claustrophobic. The gameplay largely is stuff we've seen before. I'll get to how you deal with enemies, but ultimately, at the end of the day, it is still you are shooting them. There's not really, there's not particularly any gameplay elements in this that you just genuinely have never seen before, pretty much. There are a few mini games along the way in this. And of course, there will be times where that's the wonderful thing about automatic doors. They're automatic, but they're not always fast. And there are a lot of times in this where you'll be going to a door and pressing to open it, and time will pass before it opens, and you may have to pull a Jason Bourne on that one. And then there are, of course, platforms, typically elevators, but I'm really glad they did horizontal platforms as well, where it's gonna take you a little time to get from where you are to where you're going, and it's possible that enemies might just attack along the way, and would you look at that? You have nowhere to run to, and you have very little space to maneuver to avoid the enemies. Because, and you might, and they won't even necessarily get like completely up in your face, because a ton of enemies in this can crawl on surfaces. So, and that, yeah, those are very effective. And again, maybe with the doors, but not with the platforms. They don't overdo it. They don't, overuse that element. And you will, of course, be scavenging for items. Enemies will drop, an item of some sort when they die. And it's the typical role play. You can ask the very pertinent question, why was there money inside of this space beast? Exactly. It's just slightly strange. I think watchmojo.com just did a video on, pointing that out very recently, I want to say, at least, among other video game logic things that don't correspond with real world logic. And there are these like automated stores throughout the ship, and basically these are the only place that you get to buy and sell things at the store, and you can actually like it has a safe as well, which, come to think of it, does that mean that if there were other people on the ship, particularly still, would we share a safe? Because it never actually asks for a password. I suppose it could be like it checks your identity in some way. Anyway, and the one thing about this, although to be fair, maybe on higher difficulty settings that is the case, I kind of wish that, like System Shock 2, these were very rare. That maybe one place on the overall, like, to be fair, you are not forced to use it. If you want to make the game more challenging for yourself, you can just choose. Actually, I withdraw my, yes, you don't have to use them. It's entirely up to, but yeah, in System Shock 2, you are legitimately forced to, if you want to, upgrade this or that, and regardless of which floor you're on, there might only be one of those upgrade things on the entire floor. So, either when you get there, you make sure to upgrade, or when you've done more on that floor so that you are able to spend more to upgrade, you can go back there and then upgrade, but you are forced to stick to those. But yeah, the pretty much the one thing I have against the I do want to say I really love that. I when I got this, I did not know that there would be as many role-playing game elements as there were, because I do tend to I have this tendency to overthink the moment that there are role-playing game elements and get a little obsessive about am I making the right choice? So I tend to avoid them. But given that it does have role-playing game elements, this is one that does role-playing game elements right. And basically the way I see role-playing game elements, when we're just, we're talking upgrading, we're talking limited inventory, that kind of thing. Choosing what, you choose what to carry with you, and anything that, and you choose when to use these things. If like, actually, I should finish the specific thing about the store, the automated store. I kind of wish that you have infinite storage space in these. There is just, it will never tell you have reached the storage limit. And given that, I really, because there are ones that have limited storage space. Again, been a long time since I played Resident Evil 2, but I'm almost 100% sure that when you store things in that game, there is a very limited, and that one also does, that one also challenges you more by having less of these, storage locations. But in that, you have to choose, do I want this one clip of ammo, or do I want this healing item, or what do I want to store, what do I want to keep on me? And the in this, given that there's infinite space, I don't know why they didn't make the scrolling through it more convenient. I and to anyone who says, well, they don't want you to rely too much on us, and in that case, I really, again, I'd say they should have made it limited instead. Making it this unappealing, again, I don't think they meant to. I don't think that they completely thought through just how much you can store if you don't. And again, it's just if you don't store everything you can, just it makes it a little annoying to use instead of making you forcing you to pick and choose between. Again, compared to your actual inventory is very limited. So in that regard, you have to choose what do I want to carry? That is doing it right. The thing with the scrolling in this is that every time there is a full clip, it lists that separately. Instead of having an overall listing that says, this is where you have the full clips for that particular type of ammo. So, when you scroll through, the further I got in the game, the longer I had to scroll past the ammo for like the first gun I have. I got. And again, to anyone who said, well, you don't have to store that much. The thing is, the moment that you can store that much, and it's the first gun and the ammo is super common, on some level you have you're like, if it's that common, if it's a gun the game knows I have, I can store all this, might I need it for like a boss down the line or something? And for that, yeah, they should have just have made it more convenient for the player. So yeah, instead you just have to scroll past all of these full clips that you don't need. Another thing would be if it just allowed, if instead of scrolling past, if it had a completely separate compartment in the safe for each, each separate type of ammo, for example. But yeah. And then there are these workbenches where you can upgrade the suit and the weapons and your tools, which I'll get to. And it uses a path system. Again, role-playing game done right. Role-playing game element done right. You don't get to just say, well, I just want to upgrade all, fully max out how much power, how much damage this weapon does. If you want to do that, there will be, parts along the path that don't do anything, or maybe you'll have to, there will be other things along the way. And, if you just, yeah, and every time you can choose, do I want to upgrade now and by how much? Do I want to use everything I have to upgrade right now, or do I want to wait till later? And yeah, that is how you do it. And something pretty cool, when you at the store, when you buy a better suit than the one you have, the store will like open up this compartment and then Isaac steps inside. It closes and you're now looking at the store from outside, and it has this welding line that goes all the way from the top all the way to the bottom. And then when Isaac steps out, he will like, look over the new armor, and you can actually see on the armor where it was improved. You can, or yeah, on the suit where something was improved, because you're an engineer. What you're wearing is for engineering work. You're not wearing a military armor kind of thing. And yeah, there will be more plates of armor and such. And the limited carry capacity for your actual inventory, even if you upgrade the suit, which gets expensive, you will still have to decide what you want to carry. There are healing items, there's air refilling for the, when you, yeah, I'll get to that. And ammo, and this is, I was thinking about this, I got to thinking of, a game that does this kind of thing really poorly is Deus Ex 2. BioShock, rather. BioShock, you can carry all the ammo for all the weapons. So when you have full ammo for any weapon, you might as well just use it, because otherwise, the next time you encounter ammo, it's not, there isn't going to be any. So in this, if you want, you can go through the game using mostly one gun, if that's what you want to do. Might not be the best thing to do. But then again, can you be sure that it isn't? That's how you do role-playing game right. You have the player actually trying out these different things, making decisions, and some ammo is just more costly, and maybe it takes up more space. The let's say that you're carrying, a full, I'm just going to go with clip, even though it doesn't all go into the gun, actually. But when a completely full clip for the initial gun is like 25. So, if you're carrying around a lot of ammo for that, it's 25 per inventory slot. If you want one of the more, powerful ones, that might be only 4 to a slot. So, yeah. You have to really carefully decide these things. And really the only things that are not at all limited as far as what you can carry are the, basically what you use to buy things and upgrade things. Your cash, which is basically all for the store. And there will be items that you pick up that are just expensive that you can sell at the store for more money. And then when whenever you find an item like that, it's if I carry that around on me, then the next time I get to a store, I can make a lot of money. But if I want to carry it, maybe I have to throw away a healing item or some ammo. And again, you're making those decisions. And the other thing are these power nodes. And the power nodes are what you use to upgrade on the workbench. And there are certain doors where the you know, it's an automatic door. It needs power. And the power is, you know, it needs a power source. So you can choose to use a power node on that. There might be something interesting inside that room. You're just going to have to try. And yeah, these, you know, yeah, it really does these elements very well. Basically, you know, at the store, you can buy weapons, you can upgrade the suit, and, you know, you know, buying, you can buy ammo items, and some things that you want to buy, that before you can buy them at first, you have to, you know, give the store a schematic for that, you know, and that includes some ammo and some, you know, yeah, some of the most useful items you have to. You cannot buy certain weapons until you've given the store the schematic. Do you want to take the risk that you know, you could try to see if you can find it somewhere, that weapon, but if you have the money, if you got the schematic, you could buy it. But then the schematic, it's, that takes up an entire inventory slot. Do I want that, or do I want ammo, or, you know, and then the moment that you have brought the schematic to a store, then all of the stores will be able to sell that to you. So that certainly is, you know, it's worth considering using that inventory slot for it. And if you are really bad at using inventory, then you might be stuck, you know, without a certain item somewhere, or having, yeah, so it forces you to manage your inventory. And yeah, just it really gets these role-playing game elements so very right. And that is, again, that is one of my biggest complaints about BioShock, is how much it streamlines, how little of the role-playing game elements matter. And yeah, they just, this does it so much better, which, again, not everyone is going to, yeah, some people don't want, you know, I tend to not, like I said, I tend to try to avoid games with role-playing game elements, but when you do them right, you make the game really compelling, and again, they took that risk here. This does not have a traditional HUD. Pretty much everything is handled by holographic projections. And when you're interacting with these, you're doing so in real time. This, you know, basically when you're playing this game, you are not pausing it. If you want to pause it, you know, we're talking like saving or pressing escape. Other than that, when you're playing this game, you are playing this game. So no matter what you need to do, you have to be aware that an enemy might attack or the like. So yeah. The map has this path prediction, which is completely accurate. And that means that it flies in the face of this sense that at any time, anything could go wrong. You know, obviously when you replay it because of the linearity of the story, but the first time, you don't know when something's going to go wrong. But this path prediction tells you, One way or another, sooner or later, that door is going to open, and then I proceed that way. And that again, in system shock, you can look at the map, you can see where you are, you can see where your goal is, and you can be like, well, this is a straight line between the two. And then you go, you try to go that way, and then there's a door here that you just can't open, so you have to try another. And that just, yeah, in this, if you get to a door and it's locked, the path prediction tends to just indicate, well, just maybe there'll be a cutscene, maybe there are some enemies that are gonna pop out. And it would be fine if the path prediction on the map was entirely optional, but it's not. The moment you get the map out, you have a path prediction, so you can't piece together yourself, what path would be. So yeah. And you can also get the, outside, even if you don't open the map, you can get a path prediction. For some reason, it's called breadcrumbs in the, I don't know, I never did read the manual. I guess maybe it was in there, but when I see breadcrumbs in, under the controls, I'm like, the game is probably going to tell me what on earth that means, because it doesn't make me think that will show you the path that you have to go. Like, if I was backtracking, sure, breadcrumbs, obviously, but yeah, anyway, it gives a holographic projection of, where you need to go, so you don't have to open the map for that. And this will put the path not only on the ground, but when there are other surfaces that you can travel via, yeah, it will put this predict, excuse me, on those surfaces as well. And that is genuinely utterly invaluable, because there are times where you really cannot use the yeah, where the map itself is not very, yeah, especially in these kind of zero gravity kind of situations. And as others have pointed out, the map and these other holographic projections can be something of a jumbled mess. The map itself becomes useless for not most of the game, but at pretty much in almost every single level, there is at least some point, and some of them it's the entire level, where you can't see it properly, because the map will show the numerous floors in the specific level you are, and long corridors in, to scale, instead of just listing them, which System Shock 2 does. If System Shock 2 did this, it would be a mess there as well. But in System Shock 2, when there is, okay, this area, there's more than one floor you can, in on this of the overall floors, here's, like a smaller elevator or ladder or the like. It literally just, directs you to another part of the overall map where you can then see exactly what is the, yeah, rather than you having to try to look. I don't know why they did this, and I don't know why, at least if there is an option to get it in 2D, I didn't find that option. But yeah, that would pretty much solve it. And I'm not saying, make the whole map 2D, because I get that a lot of people wouldn't, would be annoyed with that. But yeah, as it is, it's just difficult to read. And that is something a map never should be. And again, this is not them saying, well, it's going to be a little more difficult. There's no good reason for it, especially considering if you don't read the map. Again, you can't see the map without it showing all these things. Either you just use breadcrumbs gradually, because you can only see as far as you can see with your own eyes in the in-game. Yeah, it makes it really irritating a lot of the way, and you have to turn it around a lot, zoom in, zoom out, and that's not going to help you much, but you have to spend a bunch of time just playing around with this, just trying to get a better view, and ultimately you're going to just, see, okay, well, this is the basic direction I have to go in, and it looks like there's a corridor, that looks like there's an elevator, then I just have to do that, and then when I get to the end of that, I have to check it again. And yeah, that's just not, especially considering sometimes it will happen while you are, in danger, or there's something, yeah. The puzzles tend to be pretty basic and repetitive. It boils down to slow something down so that you can pass it. Like, an example would be maybe there's a fan, a huge fan that you have to pass. Okay, so you walk close to it, you slow it down, and then you move past it before it stops being slowed down. You move something out of your path, and you dodge something dangerous. That's pretty much it. It's really too bad, because there are some really creative uses of some of these, and the level design gets creative so much of the time that it's a lot of fun, but not so much that it gets gimmicky. And yeah, it's really too bad that it didn't, expand to this as well. And that is, again, where it is just, it's an action-oriented game. It is, maybe, I suppose you could say it has easy adventure game elements, but it's not going to challenge you particularly on that. It does have zero gravity sections. Before Inception introduced zero gravity fighting to, the movies, and then everybody and their mother tried to copy it, in this, you can legitimately jump to and from almost any flat, safe surface. Obviously, you can't go to, places with, dangerous, stuff you can't actually walk on, you won't be able to go to, and stuff that wouldn't be safe to land on. Yeah, and obviously, it is customary to hum Blue Danube as you walk, the entire, there are round rooms where you walk up onto the ceiling, and yeah. And you will have to both, you certainly will have to fight, and maybe there'll be times where you have to run in zero G, and that's where the problems with it, this altered perspective come in. I realize it's not, we can't expect it to be as smooth as Portal. Came out so soon after, and it, in Portal, the auto-correcting the view just has to be, you can never be, you can't be on any other surface, because gravity is in full effect in the Portal games. You can, temporarily appear out of, the ceiling or a wall, but then you immediately land, and yeah, the auto-correcting the view just means that it goes back to, just looking in the, it's back to the way it was before. It's, you are standing on the the ground or the floor or the top of something, but you're not standing on the wall or on the ceiling. So yeah, it's not safe to, it's not fair to expect it to be as smooth as Portal, but you really, I really was expecting it to handle it better than this. Basically, the camera moves slowly when you reach a new surface, and this is again where the fact that Isaac is not centered becomes a huge problem. It just, it's, it doesn't have, like, and there is a, you know, at least one boss fight that is in this, you know, yeah, done like this. In, you know, Alien vs. Predator 2, and possibly, it's been so long since I played, and I was not that impressed by the 2010 AVP, but certainly in AVP 2, there are, you know, when you're crawling on the, you know, other surfaces as the alien, you can get these arrows, you know, you don't have them when you're looking at the world with this, you know, either you have that or you have this vision that's good for being in the dark, but you can get these arrows that, you know, show you if you are right side up, upside down, or on one of the sides. And just something like that would have helped tremendously. I, you know, and yeah, this could be holographic. Why wouldn't that be useful in just using, you know, basically everything holographic is something that's useful. That would be useful if Isaac Clarke was just going around on this huge ship when it worked. And you're telling me that walking around, you know, his suit is made for it, so why doesn't it have a holographic indication of which surface he's on? When, you know, I mean, there are times where you can easily tell, but there are times where you, yeah, where you really can't, where you aren't looking at something that will indicate what is, you know, yeah, what is the natural surface for me to be, if there were gravity, which surface would I be on? And it's also really, I understand why they did this from a gameplay perspective, but they should have indicated this better. You can't always walk from one, you know, like, from one wall to another, even if they intersect, you know, if it looks like you should be able to walk, you won't necessarily be able to. And this is not consistent. Sometimes you can, sometimes you can't, depending on the area in the game. So sometimes you will still have to jump from your current surface to the one that it looked like you would be able to walk to. And that means you need to line up this jump, and you need to have space between your, you know, where you are and the surface you're jumping to. And this just isn't, yeah, it just, it's another frustration in the gameplay. Now, your suit does protect you from vacuum and, you know, if you're in an area where the air is toxic to breathe, and, you know, the suit does, of course, have limited air supply, which does mean, I wasn't able to get this working myself, I guess there are probably video guides, but it does apparently enable you to make love out of nothing at all, I don't know how. And Isaac will make sounds of suffocating long before he is. And, you know, there are other times where, like, the heart will beat when, you know, when you aren't particularly threatened by health. That happens a lot less. Well, you know, or at least it's rarer for you to be in a situation where you, where your current view, which is, you know, that is the worst of you trying to look around you, is when you are in zero G on another surface. That is when it is the hardest to get your bearings and to see where you're supposed to go and how to get there and all of these things. And when you're running out of air, when it sounds like you're running out of air, you might be looking around and you might have trouble seeing the indicator. It is on its back, so but yeah, it and the heart beating, again, I get it. It's to denote his state of mind. But the heart beating, usually you can very quickly see how much health you have. That is also on his back, but yeah, it's easier to, yeah. And refilling, you don't, there might be times where it's incredibly difficult to get through the area where you can't breathe, without having, before, without any refilling of the air. And there are items for refilling the air, and there are these static, objects that refill it as well. But again, that means inventory space, that means making your way to the refill station. And using your inventory when you are at risk is frustrating. It takes about a second for it to fully, between you pressing the button and the display fully coming up, and then you might have to scroll through items in order to refill the air. I don't know why it doesn't have a hotkey. Healing does, but yeah, and just in general, if you have to suddenly check, okay, how much ammo do I have, or what guns do I still have ammo for? That again, it takes a full second, and sometimes you're fighting for a very long time without. And so, yeah, either you made sure to know before and you kept a record of, you keep it, you've memorized it and you're keeping track, or suddenly you are just stuck in this situation. Even if that is the case, sometimes you might be stuck. And yeah, it's just, and it really didn't need to happen. It just, yeah. Something I do want to say, this, I always appreciate when a game does this. You cannot select an empty weapon that you do not have ammo for. You can't accidentally be standing there with a gun that is empty. And you can't refill it. But then the moment that you pick up more ammo, add it to your inventory, you can select the gun and then reload it. That I greatly appreciate. I hate scrolling through empty weapons to get to the ones that, yeah. And there are a lot of save stations, and it works out to checkpoint saving basically, but it is not automatic, which means you get to choose, just how rarely you want to save. If you're like at a save station, you're like, I don't know, I don't want it to be that easy. I still want to challenge myself some more. You can check the map, see where the next save station is, and then go there. And conversely, if there's a save station very close to an objective that, yeah, you can save, maybe completing some of the objective. You can save before you, if you know that when you've fully completed it, there's going to be a very tough fight or something. And there is apparently DRM on this, and originally it was really obnoxious. I haven't encountered it at all since I played through Steam. And I'm not gonna say that you have to play it through Steam, but just that is an option. If you want to play this, you don't want to deal with DRM. And the loading times are, yeah, I've seen worse, but they're long. I'm not saying that you don't get used to the controls. I'm saying that you shouldn't have to. The basic... Yeah, the controls were probably the single thing that most, you know, that most reviewers had their own, you know, briefly. There were very few who defended them. To go through, they've been called unconventional, inconvenient, awkward, bad, not direct, clunky. Yeah, I concur. And the mouse especially has been, you know, it's impossible to use it precisely. It's floaty. It, you know, the acceleration is awful. And there's mouse lag. Turning and moving around is just slow. And there's not really anything, you know, that's just how the game is set up. And looking to the sides is not on the same sensitivity as looking up and down. It's really, yeah. Again, you get used to it, but you shouldn't have to. Others have noted it's, you know, at times it's like you're controlling a tank rather than controlling, excuse me, a person. Or maybe that, like, I don't know, that he had severe, like, problems just walking around. And, you know, I can appreciate, you know, when you're, like, in zero gravity, sure, it's a little, you know, it's not going to be completely natural. But even when it should be completely natural, it, yeah. Silent Hill 1 through 3, again, the actual Silent Hill games, have tank controls. A lot of people resent that, but the reason that it's, you know, the guys in the Silent Hill experience point out that's not bad controls, it's deliberate choice. The reason tank controls can work in the first three Silent Hill games, and I replayed the entire, you know, series very recently. The enemies are rarely too fast or too numerous at any one point that it feels slow, or feels too slow, at least. It, you know, yeah, those take getting used to, but it's supposed to be. It's part of the experience. And in this, you know, the moment that you have to aim carefully to shoot a lot of enemies, maybe they're, you know, moving a lot, maybe they're moving really fast as you're shooting at them. At that point in survival horror, you can have proper first-person shooter or third-person shooter aiming without it ceasing to be a survival horror game. Yeah, this is what System Shock 2 does. You know, if you... System Shock 2 has the controls of basically a first-person shooter a lot of the way. And in this, yeah, you're always playing catch-up and often losing. And it's just, it's annoying and boring. And no, I'm not criticizing it because I had trouble with it. I, like I said, I got used to it. But it was always uncomfortable, it was always awkward, and it always took away from the experience. And basically, you know, you can't really aim at will. It's not going to aim the way you just... Yeah, it doesn't feel like a natural way to aim. And this gets... There are only a few times, but this gets especially obnoxious at certain times. And let's, yeah, it actually, not a spoiler. If you're grabbed by a really long, like, tentacle arm kind of thing and pulled by this arm for a while, if you don't manage to shoot the arm, if you can't shoot the arm apart so that it will have to let you go, eventually when it's pulled you all the way down that corridor, it will kill you. And this, yeah, it doesn't take that long, but it takes a number of seconds, and during this, you're especially hampered. That doesn't have to be a problem. There are times where survival horror and just games that want to challenge you a little more, where, at times they throw in like a curveball like that, and then you just have to adapt to that. The problem here is that it's added on top of the other problems. And you choose when and when not to aim your gun, and when you're not aiming your gun, you have it's not 360 degrees free, but it's essentially a free camera. You can place the camera in front of Isaac or to either side. The moment that you if you point in a different direction than forward, and then you walk forward, Isaac will immediately turn to face that other side. So you only turn using the mouse when the basic control keys, you strafe. You can't do anything other than that. So you can't, place the cam. You can't look behind you and then walk towards the camera. It will immediately turn. You can't, a lot of games these days have sprint function. Some you are running even if you're not sprinting. In this, you are walking. And as such, you have to choose at any given time, do I want to sprint or do I want to aim? And if you're not aiming, you can't shoot. So that's a pretty good decision. And that again really fits with, I mean, yeah, some people can run and fire a weapon. An engineer might not be able to. So yeah. And the if you're not aiming, you can use melee, but yeah. Now you can't move the map and turn your character, I suppose. Yeah, it's not even talking like comfort. You can't at all. Which I don't know if you can on console, but I could imagine that maybe you can. And when two items are close to each other, when two different things that you can use are close to each other, this is a problem in so many games. And again, I don't know for sure, but I can imagine that on console there are just different keys for it, because consoles have tons of buttons, or controllers do. The console itself has to, turn on and reset. But when you're sitting with a keyboard, you have much more limited options, and on a lot of console ports, console to PC ports, yeah, they just say, never mind, we're not going to deal with that. There shouldn't have to be a manual fix for that, but here there is. If you use telekinesis, walk away from the thing you're trying to pick up and use telekinesis, and then, you move it away from the. Yeah. And when you. Yeah, then you move the two separately from each other, and thus you get to choose which two, because you're going to encounter things that you don't want to pick up. Now, the enemies are the necromorphs, these monstrous reanimated human corpses. And they have, they have different abilities and require different strategies to take, to for you to take them out. And the game uses something called strategic dismemberment. Basically, headshots are not that useful. I'm not 100% certain, but I can imagine it's something like this human corpse is already dead. The fact that it's moving around doesn't mean that there's necessarily a lot of like higher brain functions going on still in the human brain. It's probably just easier to take the whole body, including the head, than cutting off the head and leaving it there. It's not that this thing is using, this is not even a zombie. This is straight up, this is a human body that's being used as a meat puppet by another intelligence. So, yeah, and when you cut the limbs off, that does far more damage to them than just pumping in. Like early on, I was like, I was still playing because you're used to it, So one reviewer said it was fun to having to unlearn the headshot. If you're not thinking too much about it, you might just start out just shooting them in the head, shooting them in the body. But the moment that you start shooting limbs, you're gonna realize that's the way to go. This is the way that you actually do a tremendous amount of damage with very few shots, and some enemies, even shooting off the limbs isn't going to immediately, kill them. Maybe they sprout new limbs, maybe they, split into smaller beings. And I didn't mention before similarity between this and the thing, but that's, yeah, that is where there is a similarity. And it is only that, they don't pretend to be human in this. They don't change anything. It's just that they, you have to cut them apart like that, which actually isn't necessarily sort of the thing. It's really the fact that they can sprout new limbs, and they can, if you cut off one limb, it might, just become a smaller creature. And others have noted, it's kind of a cool idea, but it is essentially a gimmick. And it's one of several gimmicks the game has. And yeah, it's a decent alternative to, your headshots and pumping bodies full of ammo. But yeah, it does lead to a pretty decent, excuse me, enemy variety. I see some criticizing it based on enemy variety. I don't know quite what they thought there should be, but yeah, it's like System Shock 1 and 2, and very unlike BioShock 1 and 2. BioShock, you just have the splicers, and some of them have different abilities, and then you have the big daddies. That's pretty much it. The System Shock games, yeah, there are a ton of different ones, and in this, there are a lot of different ones, and they're very different. Like, yeah, some of them are like humanoid, they'll have two legs, two arms, but some of them are really not. You've got really spider-like ones. Some are essentially a head with little legs, and yeah, they vary greatly in speed, movement type, size. Some of them shoot, some of them jump at you, some of them run, some of them crawl on ceilings. It's, yeah, some of them are really tiny and really fast. And this is again, in theory, I like this. It's just that the, fighting them is frustrating. But yeah, the and the AI is decent, if at all they can, they will surround you. They will come at you from every side. And yeah, maybe you have to back yourself into a corner so that they can only come at you from the one basic direction. Maybe you have to run around out in the middle and shoot some and then run to where you killed them. And in that case, you might want to focus on the ones that don't split off into just smaller beings. And some of them will avoid your attacks. And maybe you'll encounter at least a single type that you can't kill. And the appearance, the places and the ways that the monsters appear is really repetitive. Like, sometimes they'll play possum, some will, come in through vents, and yeah, it's just like I said, it's jump scares rather than, really carefully building to. And some of them will suicide with this sort of like explosive kind of thing, which, who'd have thunk? We in the West send crackers somewhere we don't belong to destroy something for our personal gain. The, who was living there, they start suicide bombing us. There are times where the enemy will like grab onto you, or a lot of small ones will like start crawling up your body and such, and you just have to mash the use key over and over. It completely takes you out of the experience of fighting. And again, they could There, like I said, there's melee. If you press your shoot key and you don't and you're not aiming, he will just like smack with the gun. I don't know why they didn't just make it so that sometimes you have to do that when a lot of really small ones are like that. Because yeah, like I said, takes you out of it. And the worst part is at the end of mashing use like that, Isaac will automatically grab it and like rip some of it off, or stomp on it. You can stomp anytime as well, but the melee really, there are a lot of times where it's really not very useful. And when you're literally watching him, like the angle will even change. You're literally just watching Isaac, put the finishing blows on this particular enemy, waiting for the game to give you back control of Isaac. I should maybe briefly note, I already mentioned that I'm probably not going to go any further into the franchise. Before anyone says, but they fix these particular, the story gets better, or the world, the characters get more compelling, and like the combat fixes this or that. If that is true, good on them for fixing it, but I'm not that invested in this. The same, I'm probably not going to get Mafia 3. It's, there's a lot to love about the first one, but then the second one is just so underwhelming. And it just, I bought both Mafia games before I had played the first one, intending to just, play the entire series. And if the second one had just fixed the issues with the first one, then I would have remained invested. But instead, they just took no chances with it at all, took no risks with it at all. I saw one reviewer say it's like the anti-Portal game. Yes, taking no risks, breaking no new ground, just giving us more of what we, you know, not being interesting in any way. Now, the boss fights are just okay. You know, some say they're amazing, some say they're, you know, underwhelming, or so, yeah, they're underwhelming. Now you have the tools of stasis, which allows you to slow down enemies or certain objects and such. And yeah, it can be useful in combat, and it can be useful, necessary, in, you know, yeah, there are certain things that you have to slow down to in order to pass them, and yeah, that's about it. And then you have telekinesis, which allows you to pick up, move, and throw, you know, quite a few items. Basically, anything that isn't too big or too heavy or like static, you can probably pick it up, which does also mean that there will be times where you'll kind of accidentally pick up like a, you know, a cut off limb or a, you know, a box or something while you were trying to pick up something else. And you know, if you pick up especially heavy, explosive or sharp objects, you can use them as improvised projectiles, and there are times where this is immensely useful, but like with the aiming and such, it's the enemies tend to be too fast and too numerous for this to be particularly useful. You know, the telekinesis is never going to be as fast as just point, you know, aiming and shooting something. So yeah. And, you know, you can, if you pick up especially, you know, large objects, you can maybe create temporary barriers, which can be useful for tactics. And, you know, there are some really cool and fun interactions there where you'll, you know, move an electrical generator, you know, again, that will power certain things need their own power source, and maybe there's an elevator, maybe you're in an elevator that you don't need to use, so you pick up, you take its electrical generator and then you bring it over to an elevator you do need to use or similar. And yeah, you know, there are certain platforms that you have to move where, you know, at one point it'll be in the way, at another point you have to move it so that you can walk via that platform to another. Yeah, and yeah, like I said, these can be cool and fun, but ultimately the puzzles using it get kind of repetitive. It's no matter how you're using it, at the end of the day, you're still just, you're picking up and moving something, you know. It's the zero gravity leads to a lot more complex and interesting, you know, puzzles and interactions. And you cannot move fast or really, you know, while you're TKing, basically, you know, whenever you use stasis or telekinesis, you're aiming, because, you know, when what you aim at is what you affect with the, yeah. So you can only move around as fast as you can, you know, look around while aiming, and walking, since you can't sprint with. So yeah, and you know, sometimes that can be really like, you know, that means that you have to be careful and focus on that, and yeah, that can lead to some good situations. And if there's an item that you can add to your inventory that's far away and you TK it, then you can immediately add it to your inventory, which is a nice, not entirely sure how that spatially is supposed to work out, but I appreciate that it's, an option. And there are times where it's super awkward to use telekinesis, where basically, if you have to move something especially large, let's say you're moving it right to left, you'll obviously start by, moving your mouse all the way to the left of, as if you were just aiming regularly. And that's not going to move the whole thing necessarily. Instead, you have to keep it at the edge there, move your mouse as far to the left as you can, and it'll slowly move. I'm not arguing the fact that some things should be slow to move. I'm saying you shouldn't be able to move your mouse all the way to the edge. Rather, it should move as your mouse does. Because as it is, it's just kind of awkward. It conveys the weight of the object, but I feel it would just be more natural to, that it would slow down how much you could move the mouse instead. And obviously, telekinesis is not this huge, like, new and innovative. It's in BioShock, where it's frankly much more comfortable to use, and it's in Half-Life 2. So, yeah. Which are both games that came out before this. The weapons are quite original, and it's basically largely improved mining tools, although there are, there is at least one military, you have an actual assault rifle as well. But yeah, what you start out with is just your plasma cutter, and yeah, I mean, obviously, this is useful for engineering, but yeah, it can be used to cut through enemy limbs as well. And, there's a rotary saw, there's this torch that's been, turned into a makeshift flamethrower, high-power demolition beam, shockwave, yeah. And every single gun has a secondary mode of fire. Now, the others have pointed out the weapons, they tend to either be really overpowered or not that useful, since you're not really the object is not to, like with the assault rifle, the object is not to put a lot of bullets or lasers or whatever into the body of the enemy. It's to cut off the limbs. And yeah, there is no rocket or grenade-based weaponry. It largely wouldn't be as useful since, again, you're cutting off limbs. The only way you can blow, that you can blow something up other than aforementioned suicide enemies is TKing something explosive, which means it's far rarer than your regular guns. And yeah, I think that's, that's just the way to go. It's actually a little strange that the flamethrower is. But anyway, and you have to conserve your ammo, and as I may have already mentioned, the melee is just, it's not that useful. I mean, think about it this way. You're always kind of slowly and awkwardly adjusting for aiming with your guns. How do you think it is when you're just trying to punch them, club them rather with your gun or stomp them when you don't move that fast to begin with? You can only carry four guns at any one time. So, yeah, you have to pick carefully, which, yeah. And it leads to unique combat. And there, your gun might have a light that works when you aim it, and maybe there will be some dark areas that you need to get through where you badly need to be able to see. Now, the reasons for most missions are mundane, and it's a lot of taxi mission, stuff. Sometimes a shortcut will open up as you get further through a specific area, a specific level. And although corridors have a tendency to be very samey, the settings are really inspired, varied, and creative, very distinct areas with themes, again, like its inspirations, very much like the System Shock games and BioShock, the Alien and Aliens. You can tell where you are and what about this made sense, before this became a haunted house in space. You go to, there's the medical area, and the morgue seems especially full, and operating tables where clearly they tried to save these people who were being infected or had been attacked, and it just did not work out. And you see all these bodies there, and in engineering is where a lot of the you see a lot of these machines really up close, and you have to turn on and then avoid this huge centrifuge. And there are times where you can gather, foreign experience with space, since you can see it right through the window. And there's actually at least one game of asteroids with, an actual with stakes to it. They even recreate the event horizon, the most memorable visual of that, the spinning. Yeah, they recreate that. It's much bigger and it's far more memorable here. Take one guess. Take just one guess whether or not you actually have to walk on the surface of the sphere there. Yeah. Now, the sound design is really, really good. There are three difficulty settings, and it is challenging even on easy. And like I said earlier, it's frustrating to play. There's no way to play this that isn't going to, it's not gonna, it's not necessarily gonna frustrate everybody, and some people are gonna say that the frustration is part of the point. But you can't play this where it'll just be a walk in the park, basically. And you have to watch your health very closely. There's fairly low replayability for a game that has as many as well and as well done RPG elements as this. And unfortunately, there's cheap difficulty along the way. It will throw enemies or sudden dangers at you while you're carefully moving something with telekinesis, for example. And yeah, it's just annoying, especially because it is an action game. So while you're trying to do this thing and that really kind of builds atmosphere and makes you appreciate the scope and makes you worry that something shows up, then suddenly a ton of enemies show up and then you just have to gun them down. And it just, yeah, it shoots us off in the foot as far as the mood goes there. And some are gonna find that the controls fight them more than the enemies do. And there are a few really sudden difficulty spikes with these insta-death spots that you then have to avoid, walking into. And it's really annoying that the first time these happen, you can't necessarily see that what you're looking at is an insta-death spot. The moment that you've died on it once, then the next time you see it, obviously you'll know. And sometimes there are dozens of the same insta-death spot, the same type insta-death spot, in a very short space of time. And yeah, suddenly you have to improvise when it was, when it was maybe already kind of annoying to play. And yeah, the gameplay goes back and forth between being too easy and frustrating. And something that also happens a bunch in this and really should never happen is you wonder whether you just saw yourself be knocked out or killed. And this is true of some enemies as well, or knocked down, rather. And if you die in an especially cinematic way, if you just die by running out of health, you might just die. But if you are killed in a way that, like, with, maybe an enemy grabs you and pulls you apart or something, this is not something that just happens. Enemies don't just walk up to you and insta-kill you if you have a lot of health, obviously. But if something like that happens, the camera pulls back and you are now watching someone die rather than feeling like you were just killed. And this is not true of all third-person games. Far from all, in fact. And if you die, you may respawn right before you did a recent objective, or right after you did something, but before it became dangerous, or the like. And like the save spots, you are not obligated to use this if you find it makes it too easy. If you respawn and you're like, this was not where I saved last, you can just, press escape, load, and there you go. And yeah, I mean, I know that the crew behind this watched and studied horror films before they made this. And again, a lot of that shows, but the moment that any enemy appears, it's not so much scary as just like fast-paced. And you're kind of fighting for your life. And even, rewatch Aliens. They are using guns, but they're still, in mortal danger and losing, And in this, at the end of the day, you're still gunning down dozens of these things. So, yeah, and you kill a lot of enemies in Silent Hill games as well, but you feel it, when you have to, several times pound an enemy with, a metal pipe, or you have to put, a bunch of rounds into an enemy. You feel it. You can tell if I, lower my guard here, this could mean my death. And that's because those know how to pace the horror, and this just doesn't. It's like they watched, it's like they tried to do kind of the thing, but they only did the really gory parts, the parts where it really jumps out at you. And, just try to watch that movie. Try to watch it once where you're only watching when someone is getting killed or there's gore. and then try watching the whole film. It is a dramatically different experience. And yeah, I think that really, that is what happened here. They focus too much on that. And it actually, I mean, if you want a shooter with, you know, with a lot of gore and like alien enemies, then, you know, this, yeah. I mean, that's another thing that when I bought this, I was hoping for horror. You know, I was hoping for something like the you know, System Shock games or the like. And yeah, you know, I suppose you could say BioShock, although it's less of a horror game. It's kind of more thriller in yeah. Please comment, thumbs up, and subscribe for more content.